Thank you. Thanks. On January 15th, 2009, an Airbus 320 piloted by Chesley Sullenberger, also known as Sully, took off from the LaGuardia Airport around 3:24 p.m. with 155 souls on board. The routine trip to Charlotte Douglas Airport remained uneventful for about 2 minutes, and that is when something terrible happened. At 3:27, the plane struck a flock of Canadian geese at an altitude of just under 3,000 feet, around 4.5 miles away from their departure. When a jetliner traveling 250 miles an hour collides with these giant birds, some of them weighing as much as 14 pounds, the damage can be extensive. In the case of 1549, both engines were critically damaged, making it impossible to reach the nearest airport for an emergency landing. The plane was going down, and Sully had no choice but to attempt a water landing in the Hudson River. In less than 90 seconds after the engines shut down, the plane made an unpowered descent into the center of the river at 140 miles an hour. Though many of the passengers were treated for hypothermia and minor injuries, all 155 people on board survived the incident. This incredible event has inspired countless news stories, books, television dramas, even a major motion picture. Most of them refer to the event as miraculous. But is it? The basis of the word miracle means that it can't be explained by natural laws, and therefore it has to be the work of divine agency. And that's the part I'm having a problem with, because it downplays all the reasons that everyone survived this incident. And let's go over what those are right now. First, we have our pilot, Sully. He's not only just a really experienced pilot, but he's also an instructor, and he's worked as a flight and disaster investigator. Sully has spent a lot of time in a flight simulator practicing and attempting different maneuvers to figure out what went wrong in other flight disasters. This is why he was able to make the right decision, the one right decision he had available to him, in 90 seconds. And let's look at the crew. His first officer, also incredibly skilled with the airplane. But an interesting fact, that flight happened to be his first flight in the A-20 since qualifying in flight simulators. And then we have our flight crew. According to all accounts of the captain, passengers, and rescuers, the entire crew professionally conducted their duties and performed exceptionally well, just as they were trained to do. And then, of course, we have the aircraft, which turns out to be an incredibly safe, well-engineered, and well-maintained aircraft. So let's compare it to other airplanes to see how well it performs when stacked up against those. If we take a look at all airliners with the best safety records, we see that for every 1 million flights, less than one person has died aboard the Airbus. This puts it near the same class of aircraft as the Boeing 747. And why? Sure, they're well engineered, but so is the Concorde. But let's take a look at this. So we see that in this graph that the two safest airliners in the sky also have the most flight simulators dedicated to training pilots to fly their aircraft safely. And it's not by a small margin. And let's look at what the training statistics are for commercial airliners. An Airbus A-20 simulator costs between $10 and $12 million per flight simulator. They wouldn't invest that kind of money into it if it didn't get results. Most airline pilots practice emergency safety procedures in flight simulators every 6 months. And the FAA requires between 10 and 20 hours in flight simulator to qualify for each new aircraft the pilot wants to fly. So given the facts, we should not be surprised that everyone aboard this plane survived, because this pilot made the right call. From air traffic controllers and aerospace engineers to baggage handlers, the airline industry has done everything they possibly can to train everyone as well as they can and engineer the best planes that they can to make sure that everyone has the best outcome. The airline industry has decided the fatal errors are simply unacceptable. Given the amount of money and the amount of time and the amount of effort given to ensure air safety, we should be more surprised when this doesn't turn out to be a happy ending. Aviation uses simulation training because it works. It's safer to practice doing something dangerous in a simulation than it ever will be in the real world. Have you ever heard of the saying, we learn more from our mistakes? Well, there's a lot of truth to that. There is value in learning what not to do when there are no real-world threats, risks, or costs. Repetitive practice builds proficiency, and motor learning is significantly enhanced when the practice variables are manipulated to promote cognitive effort by the learner. This is why video games get harder as you go through them. Simulation makes it possible to throw all manner of challenges at a trainee to test their skills. Simulation software can measure every response and deliver objective analysis of the user's ability to perform and respond. And simulation has been used by aviators for a really long time, as far back as 1914, when they used it as a military gunner training. Edwin Link and his brother George, who invented a device to train pilots working at his father's piano and organ factory in Birmingham. No one really paid much attention to these simulators that were used mostly in amusement parks. That is until 1934, when the Army Air Corps lost 12 pilots in 1 week. Shortly thereafter, the Army Air Corps ordered a fleet of simulators from the Link Corporation. By the end of World War II, 500,000 pilots had received training in Link trainers. In the 1950s, cockpit procedural training simulators had become an FAA-required standard. And in the 1960s, motion simulating platforms became indistinguishable from aircraft flight characteristics. And it's not just aviation. Almost all mission-critical industries use simulation-based training to reduce human errors that cause critical disaster. Deep sea oil rigs, nuclear power plants, surface petroleum drilling, and gas fracking operations use simulation testing and training to ensure that their staff know exactly what to do when anything goes wrong. Welcome to the X1, Oil Drilling Operator Training Simulator, capable of simulating and evaluating all functions and responsibilities of a drilling operator. On the water, Barge Captain Training Simulator is capable of challenging sea captains with unlimited fastballs under every conceivable water condition. And we have the military, who's been using simulations for a very long time as well. Many of the vehicles they drive, from tanks to Humvees to submersibles to drones, have simulation-based training programs to go along with them. Breach teams are given holographic training through augmented reality systems. Artillery has become more accurate due to advanced simulation-based training in mortar shells and calling in airstrikes. Soldiers are learning to deal with toxic gases on the battlefield by being exposed to toxic gases. Okay, so that one's not a simulation. Fair enough. But the fact remains, the use of simulation-based training as a standard qualifying requirement for certification is used in nearly every major industry where decision-making errors result in human fatalities. Over 90% of all accidental deaths are caused by human error. According to the CDC, accidents kill about 150,000 people a year. A significant number of those deaths, unsurprisingly, happen on the road. About 18,000 of them occur in the house, and a majority of those are caused by falls and unintentional poisonings. This makes work a safer place to spend your time than at home or in your car, with only 4,500 fatalities on the job annually. So when we compare these to commercial flying, which claimed only 79 lives in 2017, and only 35 of those were actually on board the aircraft, as the other 44 were fatal injuries sustained by the ground crew, we realize that a seat in business class is significantly safer than on your toilet seat in your bathroom. given that 40,000 injuries occur there. That's only for the ones that get reported. Taking a selfie is more dangerous than flying to Hong Kong. And really, that one, that source is worth looking up. There are some incredible stories there of people doing some really dumb things to take a picture of themselves. And here's the situation we're in. 100% of fatalities that are caused by human error are 100% preventable. And simulation-based training is the most effective way to reduce those errors. And here's another correlative study. If we look at the availability of simulation-based training on the airlines, it's standard. And at work, it's moderate, but it is increasing. And deaths are way down since OSHA started doing training. At the house, it's not really applicable, but maybe there's a virtual reality toilet simulator coming. I just haven't heard about it. And in cars, amazingly enough, it's nearly non-existent, but there have been some studies that show between 22 and 35% improvement. But even if you added up all of these preventable deaths caused by human error, there's one industry in particular that trumps them all. According to a Johns Hopkins study, more than 250,000 Americans die each year from medical errors. And if these findings are correct, that means that medical mistakes are the third leading cause of death in the US, just behind heart disease and cancer. And simulation-based training isn't a part of this industry yet. It's in its very early stages, but the early results are promising. And the challenge here is that there is a severe shortage of content. So to put this into a proper perspective of how likely you are to be affected by any of these in terms of death toll, if Sully were to crash a fully loaded airplane into the wing of a major metropolitan hospital twice a day for a year, he still wouldn't be able to match the carnage caused by medical errors. And simulation-based training in medicine could do so much good. It could reduce medical errors by as much as 38%. And that would save almost 100,000 lives a year. Not to mention billions of dollars lost due to medical malpractice. Virtual reality is poised to create a revolutionary advancement in medical training. And we at Ghost Productions are excited to pioneer this new field and make a huge difference and improve healthcare for everyone.